open it and stick your head out and yell, I'm as mad as hell and I'm not going to take this anymore.
This is the Tearing Down Idols podcast, where we strike at the root of America's problems. Greetings and welcome to the fifth episode of the Tearing Down Idols podcast, where we strike at the root of America's problems. In this episode, we're not so much going to be talking about the root of America's problems as much as exploring some of the things that are going on in our common era and trying to put them in a Christian perspective, and that perspective being one of hope. I'm your host, Paul, and we're going to revisit something that I've mentioned previously, I think back in the third episode, and that was the fall of the current regime that we happen to be living in. I felt I had to go back to that because I'd run across a couple of things that made me think of it, and I wanted to follow up on it, but also it's a massively important thing that we recognize this and live accordingly, that we recognize that this current regime is going out. And live accordingly. And by that, I mean to walk circumspectly and be ready to take action when the time comes, whatever the circumstances might require. But also, I want to explore what's happening right now and compare it to Scripture, because I think we'll find some astounding parallels. Now, I'm going to warn you, at first this stuff might seem scary, but keep in mind, it's all about your mindset. Again, it goes back to that fear and faith thing that we've talked about before. It's about your mindset and how you tend to interpret these things. What I'm trying to do in this particular episode is lead up to a message of hope that I at least find very exciting. So the first thing I'm going to do is play some clips for you to listen to. The first handful are from a documentary that you can find on YouTube. It's titled Humans, Gods, and Technology. It's worth listening to, I think. It's worth watching, especially from a Kingdom Christian perspective, because it really drives home the relationship between religion and government and how those two things are inseparable. This documentary is secular, and yet it really opens up some channels of thought for us in understanding that relationship between religion and government. Now, the guy we're going to hear from is named Yuval Noah Harari. He's a bagel, he's a sodomite, and he teaches at the University of Jerusalem in Israel. But the main thing to remember about him for this particular episode is that he is a foremost advisor to Klaus Schwab. And Klaus Schwab is basically at the helm of the World Economic Forum and the so-called Great Reset, and incidentally is also a sodomite bagel. Anyway, check out what Harari has to say here in this excerpt from Humans, Gods, and Technology.
And the new powers that we are gaining now, especially the powers of biotechnology and artificial intelligence, are really going to transform us into gods. And I don't mean this as a kind of literary metaphor. I mean it in a literal sense that humans are acquiring divine abilities, especially the ability to create and to design life. Just as God in the Bible designs and creates animals and plants and humans according to his wishes, now we are learning how to design and create life.
Okay, now, in this era of genetic engineering, and now the Rona jab, which they openly admit reconfigures the DNA of the recipient, and the growing talk about transhumanism, merging man with technology, this is nothing other than man creating man after his own image. In other words, playing God. Divinity has always been the goal of human government. And this is exactly what's happening here. The lure of becoming God has led us astray from the very beginning. It's precisely what led Adam and Eve to partake of the forbidden fruit.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, Ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God hath said, Ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. And the serpent said unto the woman, Ye shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
What Harari is describing here is man ascending from creation to creator. And the first thing you need to become a god or a creator is information. And with that information comes power. So I don't think it's a coincidence that we're living in what's called the information age, and it just so happens to be the same era in which man seems to be finally reaching that coveted god status. After all, didn't the serpent tell Eve that knowledge would make her like God? So I think it all fits together. Let's hear more from Harari.
You call, the future, the century of dataism, or the age of dataism.
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
In essence, dataism is the idea that if you have enough data on a person, especially biometric data, and if you have enough computing power, you can understand that person better than the person understand himself or herself. And then you can control this person, manipulate them, and make decisions for them. And we are getting very close to the point when Facebook and Google and the Chinese government know people far better than these people know themselves. Democracy and the free market and individualism and liberalism, these are all predicated on the basic assumption that nobody knows me better than I know myself. So nobody should take decisions for me. And nobody really understands how I feel and what I think. And this was true throughout history. Nobody really knew who you are and how you feel. Even if the Catholic Church, or say the KGB in the Soviet Union, followed you around everywhere and always listened to every conversation you have and analyzed it and so forth, they still didn't know who you are. They still didn't really know how you feel and what you think, because they didn't understand biology well enough, and they didn't have enough computing power to make sense of these immense amounts of data. So this was always true, but it's no longer true now. Or it won't be true in 10 years. In 10 or 20 years, somebody like Google or like the Chinese government will have enough data on you, enough understanding of biology, and enough computing power to understand you better than you understand yourself, to understand your feelings, your thoughts, your desires, your obsessions. You don't know why you feel the way you feel, but Google knows, or the Chinese government knows.
So in other words, man is achieving the omniscient qualities of God through technology and through AI. All that information, by the way, is packed into a cloud, whether we're talking about Apple or Google, a data cloud. And I seriously doubt that these technocrats use the word cloud accidentally. God is associated with clouds. For example, the cloud that hovered over the children of Israel during their trek through the wilderness, or the cloud on Mount Sinai, or in the Psalms when David says, God makes the clouds his chariot, Psalm 104, verse 3. Like I said, information is power. And these guys want it all so they can know all, see all, control all, be all. They want omnipotence as well as omniscience because the two go hand in hand.
People make sometimes such terrible mistakes in the most important decisions of their lives because they don't really know themselves very well. But these algorithms, these systems, will know us better. They won't be perfect. They don't have to be perfect. They just have to be better than the average person in order to gain control. And that's the end of all these old institutions and ideologies of individualism and free market and democracy and so forth.
And there it is. The ultimate goal of this overarching totalitarian scheme is control and the elimination of everything that comes along with being human. Everything that comes along with a free and self-sufficient society. A true God is sovereign. And just like God puts thoughts and ideas into our heads and dictates how things happen in our lives as a society and as individuals, these psychos want to have that exact same power and sovereignty. They want to kick God, kick Christ off of his throne and take the seat for themselves. They want to elevate themselves to heaven, as we read about the king of Babylon in Isaiah 14.
How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in thine heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High.
Let's see what more Harari has to say.
Do you see it as a new religion?
Yeah, we need to understand what religion is. People think religion is about God. Religion is not about God. Religion is about humans. In essence, religion is a story that gives legitimacy to human norms and values and laws, and that validates a source of authority. Religion is when you have a big question in life and you need an answer. What is the source of authority? Religion explains to you, tells a story that explains what is the authority that can answer your question.
Okay, so what he's doing here is marking and recognizing a distinct connection between religion and authority, or religion and government. The one you look to for all your answers, not to mention for provision and protection, is your God. And what Harari is saying here is that we're entering a new era in which data and algorithms, man-made or artificial intelligence, will dictate to us whatever is true or right. And of course, in the end, we know who's behind all these algorithms. None of these algorithms are organic. By organic, I mean they aren't allowed to develop independently based on raw information. They're manipulated. They're manipulated into giving specific outcomes. I remember a while back, they had to take down Alexa's algorithm and adjust it because it was giving some answers to people that caused an uproar by being quote-unquote racist. They were correct answers, but they weren't socially acceptable, so the algorithm had to be changed. They had to manipulate the algorithm to suit the current needs for the powers that are. So, none of these AI algorithms are evolving independently in cyberspace. They're carefully pruned and shaped to serve the purposes of the technocrats.
You want to know whether two men can marry. You have this dilemma, this question, can I marry my boyfriend as a man? And you ask the Bible. And the Bible says, no, it's a sin. So you don't do it. It's the source of authority. And then you have a modern ideology like liberalism, and it tells you, oh no, the source of authority is not the Bible. The source of authority is human feelings. You just need to consult your own feelings. If something makes you feel happy and makes your boyfriend feel happy and you don't harm anybody, then there is nothing wrong with it. Go ahead and do it. If it feels good, do it. This is the basic story of liberalism, that the highest source of authority is not God, it's not the Bible, it's human feelings. So if we understand religion in general as a story about authority, then in the 21st century, we will have a new dataist religion or a new algorithmic religion, which will tell people the source of authority is algorithms, is big data algorithms. If you have a big question in life or a small question in life, the source of authority is the big data algorithms.
So there you have it. A new religion which aims to supersede all other sources of information with its data and algorithms. And really, when you think about it, we're there already. Nearly everyone today, if they want to know something, they go look it up on Google or Wikipedia. If they want to know if something is true or false, they run to Snopes. Our first impulse now is to just run to the internet and find out what the internet has to say on just about any topic. Even preachers are cutting and copying and pasting their sermons. I've caught at least one doing that. Cracking a book, actually opening a book that you take off the shelf and turn pages to read, is becoming a lost art. Libraries are becoming computer hubs as opposed to places where people can find information in the pages of a book. Now, today, learning something is just a matter of typing it into a search engine or asking Alexa, and then boom, there's your answer. Straight from the world of ones and zeros, straight from the cloud. Oh, and by the way, what does Harari think of all this?
I'm not implying it's necessarily a bad thing, because it will be a very good thing in many respects.
Well, of course he'd think this was great. To put the great human herd of the global plantation into an automated system that controls everything from what they think and believe to what they eat, to where they live, to what they do for an occupation, everything determined by the all-knowing data god. These next clips are from another source. It's still Harari speaking, but notice what else he has to say here.
Humans are now hackable animals. You know, the whole idea that humans have, you know, they have this soul or spirit and they have free will and nobody knows what's happening inside me. So whatever I choose, whether in the election or whether in the supermarket, this is my free will. That's over. Free will, that's over.
People could look back in 100 years and identify the coronavirus epidemic as the moment when a new regime of surveillance took over, especially surveillance under the skin, which I think is maybe the most important development of the 21st century, is this ability to hack human beings, to go under the skin, collect biometric data, analyze it, and understand people better than they understand themselves. This, I believe, is maybe the most important event of the 21st century.
By hacking organisms, elites may gain the power to re-engineer the future of life itself. Because once you can hack something, you can usually also engineer it.
Now, scripturally, we know that life is a power and a gift created and granted solely by God, the Creator. But here we find that man wants to hack life. In other words, hack DNA, and then having gained access to re-engineer it. What they're talking about is venturing into a realm that is specifically and exclusively the realm of divinity. That's dangerous stuff. That's barging right into the throne room of the Almighty and telling God he's sitting in your chair. See, as scary as this stuff sounds, I would maintain that instead of achieving their goals of God status, these destroyers are going to get an almighty backhand and find themselves cast down to the earth again, just like Isaiah 14 describes. What we're looking at is a rebuilding of the Tower of Babel.
And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass, as they journeyed from the east, that they found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there. And they said one to another, Go to, let us make brick, and burn them throughly. And they had brick for stone, and slime had they for mortar. And they said, Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down to see the city and the tower which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them which they have imagined to do. Go to, let us go down and there confound their language, that they may not understand one another's speech. So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of all the earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore is the name of it called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth.
When we read of the image in Nebuchadnezzar's dream in Daniel 2, we find that Babylon is the head of gold. Now the head is the seat of thought and ideas. It directs the rest of the body, the arms, the legs, the feet. The body achieves the ideas that the head dreams up. It follows the head's directives. Christ is the head of his body. Babylon is the head of human government. Human government in general is represented by this image and is controlled by a Babylonian mindset. Babylon started with Nimrod all the way back in the early days of Genesis. And it's still alive and well today. It's still trying to achieve what it was trying to achieve then. It's trying to become God. It's trying to ascend into heaven and make a name for itself. And I got news for them, but it's not going to happen. For a very long time, since the very beginning, these governments have tried to become God. But as Harari himself has said, this is an unprecedented level of achievement for them. There's an article in the Daily Mail titled, The Rich Will Become Godlike Cyborgs. Historian claims the wealthy will transform into a new type of human within 200 years. And it quotes Harari, and this is what he says. I think it is likely in the next 200 years or so, Homo sapiens will upgrade themselves into some idea of a divine being, either through biological manipulation or genetic engineering, by the creation of cyborgs, part organic, part non-organic. And then he goes on to explain that this is only going to be achieved by the super wealthy of the world, and of course, since they're the ones who want to have all the knowledge and power. The only way in which they want us peons to become cyborgs would be so they can control and manipulate us in a more efficient and complete manner. Kind of like a mothership and drone kind of relationship. Bottom line is, Babylon is stepping out of place again. God's not going to put up with it. These people want to achieve this goal in the next 13 years or so, and I personally expect God will make the whole operation blow up in their faces sooner rather than later. They're trying to rebuild the Tower of Babel. God's going to knock it back down like a bunch of Jenga bricks. That means we as Christians have a hope to hang on to that the rest of the world simply does not. Can you imagine seeing everything that's going on, knowing what our enemies are doing, and having none of this hope? We have a huge advantage as Christians. The saying goes that things are darkest before the dawn. And I think it's true, and I maintain that things may look really, really dark at the moment. But I also think we can spot a glimmer of light on the horizon. We've just got to hang on. We have to stick close to our King, follow his commandments. This is the end, folks, but that end is not for us. Scripture compares men to pottery, clay containers, since we're made from the dust of the earth. If the potter wants to smash men completely, all right, if he really wants to shatter them into dust, he's going to raise them up as high as they can go before he brings them down again. And these enemies of God are the highest they have ever been in history. I really don't think we can find historical precedents when they were even close to being this high. So when they fall, it's going to be spectacular. I think it'll be so devastating they will never recover from it. One very, very, very important thing we need to remember is that these people are mere men. They're men. Nothing more. They're just as prone to mistakes and foolishness and self-destruction as the rest of us, especially when they get cocky. The way they're doing things right now smells like huge amounts of overconfidence. They think they're on the final push to victory, but I think they've made some serious blunders, not the least of which is thumbing their noses at God and telling him to step aside. He's not about to step aside for anyone, least of all for them. The elites are crowing about finally becoming gods, but in reality, I think they're just digging their graves. And in some cases, like with these deep underground bunkers that they've made for themselves, I think they're digging their graves literally. Christ, the rock, is going to fall on them and is going to grind them to powder. As Isaiah 46:9 says, He is God. There is no one else, no one like him. These mere mortals are trying to be like the God who is spirit, who spoke the universe into existence. We should laugh at that. It's a joke. Just like in Psalm 2, he sits in the heavens and he laughs. No, they will crash and burn. It's an absolute guarantee.
You can run on for a long time. Run on. For a long time, run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Go tell that long-tongued liar. Go and tell that midnight rider. Tell the rambler, the gambler, the backbiter. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down. Tell him that God's gonna cut him down.
So there's my little bit of food for thought this round. Just remember, don't ever despair. All these things are God's work. Nothing happens outside his sovereign control. This is the time to build that faith and look forward to a new day, hopefully in this life, but definitely in the next, if we're washed in the blood of Christ. And when you hear all these things about what they are doing, remember, first and foremost, that doesn't matter. Not nearly as much as what the King of Kings is doing. It doesn't matter nearly as much as the promises he's made to his people. If we're spending more time talking about and thinking about and worrying about what they are doing, then we are focusing on the King and the promises he's made and how we can serve him, then our idol is in man. Our faith is in man. Our main concern is man rather than God. We as Christians need to stay strong in him, focused on him, just like Peter had to focus on Christ. And the moment that he lost sight of Christ and started looking at the waves all around him, he started to sink. Let's focus on Christ and his promises and his power and his strength. Anyway, thanks for listening. Subscribe, comment, share, all that stuff that people do with podcasts and videos and whatnot. Check out my website, tearingdownidols.com. Feel free to fire off an email to tdi@mail.com if you get the notion. There's so much to discuss on this podcast, and I doubt I'll ever get to it all, but I appreciate you joining me for this ride, and I look forward to seeing where it all goes. I'll see you in the next episode, and remember, stay strong, pray hard, and keep yourself under Christ and above the world.
This has been the Tearing Down Idols podcast, where we strike at the root of America's problems. Subscribe and visit tearingdownidols.com for more information. You can email the podcast at tdi@mail.com.